For the child in Delhi is that yes, everyone in Bangalore is looking at this eclipse with a very scientific eye. Please, Vijay and Rishabha, stay with us. Joining me in the studio right now is Professor Kulshreshtha. He's with Delhi University and he's a physicist. Professor Kulshreshtha, thank you so much for being here with NewX. First and foremost, my question to you, which I've been putting to all the professors and all the scientists joining us today, what's your favorite, Ring of Fire or the Diamond Ring?
Well, I like both of them actually. So I would not really like to compare the two events. The total eclipse has its own importance and the annular eclipse also has its own importance.
All right. So in fact, let's get those visuals up for the viewers in just a moment of what we are seeing today, what we saw today, that very rare once in a millennium spectacle of this long duration of the annular eclipse. Professor Kulshreshtha, that's what the people, many lucky ones, saw in Dhanushkodi today. What exactly is happening? What's this phenomenon?
Actually, what is happening is that the shadow of the moon is falling on Earth. So what is happening that these three celestial bodies, the sun, the moon and the Earth, they have come in one line. And so the shadow of the moon is falling on the Earth and we are just changing the shadow. And the distance of the moon at the moment from Earth happens to be a little bit more than what it is at the time of a total eclipse.
Okay.
If the distance, had the distance been little less mm-hmm. between moon and Earth, then this would have been a total eclipse because then this apparent diameter of the moon would have covered the entire disk of the sun. But that has not happened because moon is little bit too distant from Earth.
And that's what happened on 22nd of July 2009.
Right. Right.
And that was what is the diamond of ring phenomenon.
Right. But what is happening today is that the distance of the moon from Earth is a little bit more than that time.
Okay.
Okay. And therefore, the shadow of the moon is not able to cover the entire disk of the sun. So, you see, what happens, it depends on if I close my eyes from here or from a distance, then that decides how much can I obstruct at a distance.
Okay.
So, these three objects, the sun, the moon and the earth, and obviously you see what happens, the moon is revolving around the earth,
right.
And the earth is revolving around the sun. So we can compare this situation with the movement of two cars.
Okay.
One car is moving ahead of me and I am behind that car.
Okay.
And some light is falling from somewhere on this car, so that essentially by changing that car, I am really changing the shadow of that car, which
okay.
I can see.
Okay.
You can see it every day in your everyday phenomenon.
Okay.
Every evening you can see while traveling on the Delhi roads. So it is because these bodies are too big, much too bigger than the car.
Mm-hmm.
So the moon is also a big object and its shadow is also big. So its shadow, which is now falling on the earth, it is something like little more than 300 kilometers wide.
Okay.
Okay. And this shadow is moving on a particular path, this trajectory, which we call as the annular path.
The path of annularity.
Path of annularity.
All right.
If we just follow this path, then we will continue to have this view of annularity.
We will have to cross the Indian Ocean as well.
Yeah, no. Not only cross, we will have to travel via the ocean.
Travel via the ocean.
You see, because this path, right from Jaffna in Sri Lanka,
right.
It comes to Koti, Rameswaram, and then it goes into the sea, over the sea.
Right.
And then it enters Mizoram, Myanmar and China.
Okay.
So, during this time, it travels in the sea. And this shadow is something like 330 kilometers wide. Now, if you deviate from this trajectory, from this path,
mm-hmm.
either to the left or to the right,
okay.
then you deviate from the annularity and you see the partial eclipse. That
okay.
is what is happening in Delhi, for example.
Right.
You see the partial eclipse.
So if our car, which is the Earth, will keep chasing the moon, we
yes.
will continue to see this phenomena for as long as it lasts.
That's
today.
Correct.
I have another question for you, the duration. This phenomenon is very special. Why? Also because it's really long. The last time it was 11 minutes and 40 seconds long was way back in 1992. And they're
yes.
saying that amount will not be equaled or exceeded till 1033 years from now.
No, actually, I must correct it. In 92, we did not see an annular eclipse.
Okay.
The last annular eclipse, it occurred in India. It was 45 years ago when I was a kid. I was going to the school. So at that time, there was this annular eclipse.
Okay.
And now the next annular eclipse, solar eclipse, would be 10 years from now.
All right.
But it would not be as long as this
exactly
one.
Exactly my question.
But what, as long what as what we are having today, it would be more than 1,000 years from
1,033
now.
1,033 to be precise.
3,043 exactly. or 33, something
right,
like that.
Right, sir, 3,043 is a year.
Yes.
But exactly my question is, on what factors does the duration of this eclipse depend on? Why is the duration, why can't it be 12 minutes, 14 minutes, 15 minutes, why only this long and why such a long wait for it?
That's a very good scientific question. It depends actually on the distance of the moon from the earth.
Okay.
You see, sun is too far from both of us, moon and the sun, earth and the moon.
Earth and the moon, right.
So, this distance between earth and moon is negligible as compared to our distance from the sun.
Okay.
For both of them, we are just one object, essentially. For sun. So that means, and it is actually what happens that moon keeps revolving in a elliptical orbit around the sun, and it does not, nothing happens, nothing deviates. The moon as usual is traveling on this well-defined elliptical orbit around the earth. Now, so that means how long will it take to cross a particular sector, particular chord of that or particular arc of that elliptical orbit would depend on how much is the distance of the moon from the earth. If the orbit were little bit longer, then the annularity would be more, and time taken also would be more.
All right.
Because now the moon has to travel a larger distance, and so it will take more time. But that means when the moon goes little bit still far away from us, from earth, then the width of this ring would increase.
Okay. It'll just be on the sun then.
Yes, yes. So here I think it is very important to understand one more thing, that supposing the moon goes too far away from earth, then even there would be a position that the shadow would still be there. Mm-hmm. Moon's shadow would still be there, but there would be no earth to intercept this shadow.
Okay.
You see? So you see some shadow on some image, if you intercept, now I put my hand here and this table is intercepting, so the shadow of my hand is falling on the table, and exactly for this reason I would say that the occurrence of this event...
Is this shadow called the antumbra, if I'm correct?
No, I'm not referring to that. I'm not really referring to that at the moment.
Okay.
What I'm referring to at the moment is that... actually, our moon is receding away from the earth, let us say, at the rate of 3.8 centimeters per second.
Okay.
So, moon is going farther and farther away from earth, but at a very slow, but 3.8 centimeters per year.
So, annular eclipses will occur, but not like this, not a ring of fire. It will intercept.
So, for example, after some millions of years, maybe 60 or 50, I have forgotten, you can calculate it exactly, what will happen? That by that time, the moon would have receded too far from earth. And so it would still come in front of the sun or in between earth and the sun.
Right.
But earth would not be able to intercept this shadow of the moon. And therefore, there would be no eclipses at all.
Absolutely. And if actually, it won't fall on the earth.
So all these, our present systems like Prathama, Ditya, Chaturthi, Amavasya, Puranmasi, all these things would change tides. Would not occur anymore, there would be no eclipses anymore, and so that would be a boring time, which really means that the life on earth might start a beginning towards the end of life on our planet.
All right.
So that would be highly inauspicious. So I think we are living in the most auspicious times, that
we are able to
witness these things, and the moon is close enough to earth, and so these beautiful spectacular things
that's a very scientific view, that's how scientists will put it, that the most auspicious thing about the moment is the very fact that we are able to witness this eclipse, since this itself is a rarity, and this is the most auspicious thing. But still, Professor Kulshreshtha, there are many people out there and they'll be joining us shortly as well who will defy you on this very point and say no, it is very inauspicious. So for all the does science in a way say, we heard Professor Shukri out there saying that how if it's so unhealthy or unsafe to eat and drink, why even breathe? Why these myths around an eclipse?
No, this, you see, because our lack of scientific thinking, Mm-hmm. You see, that is the main. Behind all this, the only inauspicious thing, if it can happen, is if I stare at this eclipse with my naked eyes.
Okay.
That's the only risk. Nothing else, nothing more to it. That I must not watch this eclipse with my naked eyes, because, and in particular, the annular eclipse. Annular eclipse, you must never watch with the naked eye. The total eclipse, you can watch for some non-zero amount of time, because the entire sun disk is covered for a short time. Mm-hmm. But in the annular eclipse, the sun is never entirely covered, and so the lot of light is still coming
from the
moon line, from the sun, from all around the moon.
From that annulus which is formed.
Right, and you see, so what happens, there are radiations of all kinds. I mean, not only the visible light that is coming from sun, ultraviolet, infrared radiations, all these radiations are also coming. Mm-hmm. And they are unobstructed, and you stare at them. So there is a possibility that you might damage your retina or something. If you just avoid staring at the sun directly through a naked eye, then there is nothing else that can go wrong. It has no consequences whatsoever. I am sitting here and... I mean, it's of no consequence.
All right, so the learning out here is, we take a short break right now, but the learning before we come back in just a moment is that definitely take a look at this phenomenon, but not with the naked eye. We come back in just a moment. Keep the discussion forward. Stay with NewX. This entire beautiful spectacle is Professor Kulshreshtha, who's been with us in the studio. He's a Delhi University professor and he is a physicist who's been trying to make sense of this annular eclipse for us. Professor Kulshreshtha, you've been talking about the duration, the phenomenon, and how it's very auspicious and nothing really unsafe about it. But also talking about, if you can share with us any few points which people don't really know about solar eclipses, what would they be?
Well, people somehow over the years, some myths and some superstitions are being spread into our society, which is not a very correct thing to do, because, I do agree that astronomy has emerged out of astrology in a scientific manner. Mm-hmm. Whatever.
This annular solar eclipse was witnessed today in several parts of the country. This is the first biggest astronomical spectacle which we have seen in recent times. Like I said, the longest annular solar eclipse of the millennium. Astrology enthusiasts in India have gathered to witness the phenomena. The annular phase has started from about 10:45 this morning, when the eclipse began in the Central African Republic. It will end on the Chinese Yellow Sea coast in any moment from now, if I'm not mistaken. The duration of the eclipse was earlier predicted to be around 11 minutes over the Indian Ocean, and therefore that makes it the longest annular solar eclipse. Now, this is a rare event which happens about every 108 years. The annular eclipse will be clearly visible from a number of places. In fact, it has already been sighted in a number of places. The most privileged residents have been that of Kanyakumari, who really got a very good glimpse of that ring of fire. All right, we have with us now Professor Kulshreshtha, who is the head of the Department of Physics and Astrophysics in Delhi University. We're really privileged to have you with us. And from your understanding, you, of course, the head of the Department of Astrophysics there. So how important is this solar eclipse for academicians, for educationists like yourself? And if you can explain to us the significance of this, a lot of the common man do not understand why it is called annular, and why is it the longest, can there be a longer eclipse in future?
Well, in principle, yes. You see, the span of this kind of an eclipse, it depends on the trajectory or the path traveled by the moon during that time. You see, the moon is revolving around our Earth in an elliptical orbit.
Right.
And if it happens that at a particular moment, Sun, Moon and Earth, all these three celestial bodies, they come in just one line, then the shadow of the Moon would fall on Earth.
Right.
And now, it depends on how distant is Moon from Earth.
Right.
If the distance is right, like it happened some months ago, that means the shadow of the Moon, the Moon, it was able to cover the entire Sun disk.
Right.
Okay, and therefore it was a total eclipse.
Right.
Now this time what has happened, that the distance of the Moon from Earth is little more than last time.
Right.
And as a consequence of that, the Sun, the Moon is not able to cover the entire disk. I mean, the apparent diameter of the Moon is not able to cover up the entire Sun disk.
Right, therefore
we are able to see this ring around the Moon, which you can call ring of fire or annular ring or whatever you call it.
Right. So is the annular solar eclipse particularly rare? We have witnessed
yes.
a partial eclipse
yes.
and a total
yes.
eclipse last year,
yes.
but an annular eclipse, like which is why
this
we are
annual,
covering this.
This annular eclipse in India occurred some 45 years ago when I was a child going to a school.
Right.
And now it would occur again, say 10 years from now. And the duration of this eclipse would be bigger than this or comparable to this, maybe by some seconds or fraction of second. It
right.
would be something like 3043.
Right, so none of us would be probably alive at that time.
So more than 1,000 years from now.
Right.
And you see, the human life is too short for all these things.
Right.
Compared to astronomical scales.
Right.
On the astronomical scales, 1,000 years is nothing.
Right.
Okay, it's just like tomorrow or yesterday.
Right.
But for a human life, it's too much.
Something special.
Okay,
right, Professor Kulshreshtha, we'll come back to you. Right now, I'm told that we have our correspondent Siddharth Gautam joining us from Haridwar. Remember, that is the place where thousands of devotees are gathering to take that holy dip. They're all gathered in Haridwar there. And let's get in Siddharth right away and ask him what's happening. Siddharth, over to you. Give us a description of what's going on right now. Did the people manage to get a good glimpse of the eclipse, and how have they observed the rituals thereafter?
Well, absolutely. Let me tell my camera person to pan the camera for you and give you the glimpse of the action that is taking place in Haridwar at Harkipauri. And absolutely, you are right. A couple of people did manage to have a look at the sun with the piece of an X-ray. And other people did look at the sun without even X-ray or the glasses. I mean, they were very excited about the entire thing. Now, the eclipse is about to get over at 3:12 p.m. And that is the time that each and every person is waiting to take a dip. You can see
right.
that people have gathered on the side of Ganges, and they are just about to take a dip. I'll tell my camera person to show you the visuals of the way people are clapping at that corner. If you can see on your screen, that they are very excited about the entire thing. The people are, chanting shlokas, mantras, and bhajans loudly.
Right.
And the moment has come. Now it's the right time to take a holy dip. It's already 3:10. In another 2 minutes, you will see thousands of people getting into the Ganges and taking a holy dip. And that was the time that people were waiting for. You can see
right.
that there is a movement in the crowd. Everybody is getting ready and getting prepared to take a holy dip. I can see a few people have even started taking a holy dip. They're very excited. They're clapping. They're jumping. They're raising. They're chanting the slogans and the mantras. So the mood is quite colorful and very cheerful at the ghat of Holy Ganges at Harkipauri.
Right. Siddharth, stay with us. In fact, we have in the studio Professor Kulshreshtha, who has been explaining to us the importance of the solar eclipse. This is something that happens once in perhaps many lifetimes. And let's again understand from him. You were telling us this is going to happen after probably 1,000 years later, which is why this is so special. We are in that way privileged to have witnessed this in our lifetime. We are not going to see that great ring of fire again in our own lifetimes.
No. That's not true. We will see it 10 years from now.
Right.
But it's the duration.
Right. I was talking about that. The longest eclipse.
The duration, such a bigger duration would occur only after 1,000 years. That's,
right.
that's the thing.
So which is why we are calling it the longest in this century,
longest,
in this millennium perhaps.
Yes. So for this millennium, the currently running millennium, the third millennium, we are only in 2010, and one has to wait for 1,000 years or more
to go into
the next millennium,
right,
and to be able to see a similar, with respect to the duration.
Duration, absolutely. Duration. That's the important point here.
Yes.
Otherwise,
yes,
we will see this in 10 years from
yes,
now.
Yes.
But tell us, Professor, this must be of huge academic interest to you as well. You're heading a department of astrophysics. What do the astrophysicists look for? What are they trying to study?
This is actually a rather collective effort on behalf of the country as a whole. So what our country is doing, in particular, ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization, they are our leading fraternity people, scientific community in this area. So they have already launched a series of these rockets, sounding rockets, from yesterday and today, and perhaps maybe even later. So, and these rockets, they would be at a height something like 70 kilometers from the surface of the Earth.
Right.
Then 120 and so on, and the farthest would be more than 500 kilometers
right,
above the surface of the Earth. These rockets are primarily designed, and it's a series of them.
Right.
So it's a collective effort on behalf of the country, and this would be basically collecting data, and then we would be analyzing
right,
on the physical parameters of the Earth atmosphere and ionosphere.
Right, so there are a lot of interesting research and studies that
yes,
are going on, and we will perhaps benefit as a human race from those studies. Let's get in Siddharth once again. Siddharth, I hear that it is freezing out there. Haridwar is not very far from the national capital, but yet people are taking that holy dip with a lot of enthusiasm. What is the sentiment among people? What are their perspectives or their idea about the solar eclipse? Earlier, there used to be a time when people would not even venture out, but now just look at the change.
Well, let me first tell you that the annular solar eclipse is over in Haridwar, and let me take you right across between the crowd and show the visuals. The people are so excited, and they've started taking the holy dip.
Right.
The exact time of eclipse getting over was 3:12, and it's almost over. People have started getting into the Ganges and taking a holy dip. And you're
right,
absolutely right. Day before yesterday, it was very cold and very chilling. It was foggy. The weather was very foggy. But fortunately, it's quite sunny over here, and it's not that cold as it was 2 days before. So people
right,
are taking it very easily. I mean, it's not that cold. I mean,
right,
people are taking holy dip without any fear of cold and everything. And you can see, I mean, it's, the eclipse is over. Now it's time for people to take a holy dip and
right,
you know, carry on with their rituals.
Right, so perhaps there has been some divine intervention in so far as the weather there is concerned. Otherwise, one can just imagine what it would be like in icy cold waters. But like you're saying, it's comfortable for people to take a dip. But this is a religious conglomerate, a religious gathering there. I mean, one would imagine that people who are extremely spiritual, and who are very much into religious beliefs have gathered there. Now tell us, There are certain theories around the solar eclipse which say, people even go to the extent of saying that the atmosphere gets contaminated and therefore one should not venture out, one should not have any food. But this is a religious group of people who are just rejoicing the moment, who are just reveling in that moment, perhaps, celebrating also in some ways. Why is there, do you see that, some ways people have evolved from those age-old beliefs?
Well, absolutely, you are right. There are two sets of people who have gathered at the Holy Ganges of Haridwar. There are people who have just come for the religious reason, and there are a set of people who have just come to experience the entire thing that is taking place here. I mean, people who are for the religious reason clearly do not buy the scientific theory that you should not look at the sun or you should not do certain things. I mean, they're just absolutely okay. They think it's a religious occasion, and
right,
they take it very religiously. As far as the scientific methods are concerned.